thank you. I thank you that you have loved us and you have made us strong. Thank you that you are good and you are great and you are faithful. Thank you for your patience with us. Thank you for the privilege of coming and gathering your faith and worshiping you together, Lord, and hearing your word. And I just pray that you would be magnificent in your life.
Thank you. I'm
I'm going to go to the next slide.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
chapter 15 this morning. For the past few weeks, we've been discussing the disciplines, the spiritual disciplines, or the practices that we are going to need to apply to our lives if we are going to be all God wants us to be in 2023. Now, it was an interesting event this week, I'll let you know. I told you a few weeks ago that I had a pastor that had a great influence in my life. His name is Pastor Palmer. And he's the one that I told you that at the beginning of each year, he would have a thing, Get Alive in 95, or whatever it was. Every year he did it. And I had joked with Bob, I could do something of that nature in the beginning of 2023, and I came up with this. And would you believe that Pastor Palmer called me out of the blue, haven't talked to him in years, called me Tuesday night, I believe it was. He's 95 years old. But still, you can still raise that. I told him, if you come up here, he says, listen, Nick, my name is not being called for preaching. No one wants to hear from 95 year old man. He'd be welcome here if he comes. Amen. Anyway, I would tell him that the theme I had chosen a theme that he did years ago. And I told him the theme, and he said, that's good. That's good. So this that we're doing is Pastor Palmer approved. Praise God. But in the first week, we discussed the importance of worship as a foundation to these disciplines, because we can do all these things and go through all of these motions. You know, these things that we have been talking about, it's not just checking a box. Reading God's Word is not just checking a box. We need to approach that in a spirit of worship so that we can acknowledge and absorb as much of the Word of God in our lives as possible. Allowing the Holy Spirit to have his influence over us as we read God's Word. It's so important to read God's Word, for this Word, His Word, is the roadmap in our lives. You want to know how to please God? Read God's Word. You want to know how to get to heaven? Read God's Word. If you have questions about how you can live, read God's Word. It's the roadmap for us. Last week, we passed the practice of prayer. Once again, not just checking a box, but the practice of prayer. Jesus indicated it is not a question of if you will pray, it's when you pray. And it's a practice of drawing close to Him and allowing Him to draw close to you and walking with Him and allowing Him to walk with you. Now today we want to shift just a bit and speak of a practice that is easy to talk about. Challenging practice. John 15, I was talking and not turning. Let me head over there quickly. It's so short, I tell you, it's a good story. But this is my command. It's my command. This is Jesus speaking. This is my command. You know that it's a command and not a suggestion. It's not a suggestion. It's not an encouragement. It's His command for us. Love each other. This is my command. Love each other. Easy to talk about. But what a challenge to accomplish and to do. Lord Jesus, I just thank you this morning for your presence. I thank you for your faithfulness to us. I just pray that you open your word to our hearts. I pray that you would open our ears that we might hear from you. Thank you for the privilege of looking into your word.
And Lord, I pray that you would help us to learn how to love as you, God, desires us to love. To hear it over. It's the end. It's love one another. The reality is he knew it is a challenge. God knows you better than you know yourself. He knows that our tendency is not to love. Not to love our enemies. Not to care about those per se that aren't useful. Right. You know, but that kind of love isn't actually love. The reality is that loving each other or loving others is a real challenge. That is why we had to make it a command. If it was easy for us, we could just let it go and we would be able to. We would just naturally do it. But you know, you can't, especially in this area, you can't just do what comes naturally. Because what comes naturally is not loving each other. In his first letter, John wrote in chapter 3, verse 18, "Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth." It's sweet to say, "I love you, man." But to really love someone. To really, really love them. You know, talk is cheap. And those words are very true. Of the two kids, I have two kids, and they have been guilty of fighting each other with each other. And I was that parent that would say, "All right, apologize to each other." You ever done that with two kids? Are you sorry? It's not in their hearts, but they're saying it. But it's not in their hearts, but you make them say it anyway. And then, "I love you, man." But love was nowhere in their hearts. Jesus didn't say, "Flatter each other with words." Sometimes we express flattery, but yet the truth is we couldn't care less. I love you. He said, "Love one another." Again, in 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the expiation for our sins. God has loved us, and you have experienced the blessing of God's love in your life. His desire is that you would love others as he has loved you. I heard something the other day that was very, very appropriate. Do you know that your love for others will go no further than your love for God? Your love for others will go no further than your love for God. In order for you to love others, you must love them. If in your own life, you try to flatter God, then good luck. That is what your love for others will look like as well. Love for others has a feeling as it pertains to our love of God. Now, this command to love has a few different applications. And it starts with loving God supremely. the more I am successful in loving God in every area of my life, and that's the difference. The greatest commandment, Jesus said, was to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. That is our goal. That's the greatest commandment, according to Jesus. Love the Lord your God with everything you've got. Hey, you got to think about it. Isn't that stupid? To put God first. To put God first in all things. That's what we just said. To have Him as the priority in every area of your life. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, standing on the foundation of worship, experiencing or understanding that that is your spiritual act of worship. He followed that up by saying what the second command is. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself, but you can't love your neighbor as yourself until you have learned to love the Lord your God with all your heart. You know what I'm saying? We must develop and train and strive for that love with God, that love for God. And as we do, our ability to love each other or one another is enhanced. Putting God first at all times. And then in the context of putting God first at all times, then John 15:17, this is my command, love one another. It would present a real problem because we don't love some people. Some people have us for a long way. Some people are grumpy. Some people are ugly in their actions. Well, they're just not very nice. Some of our neighbors are unlovable. Now, if you're honest, as you sit there, someone that I was just describing flashed into your mind. You can't help it, can you? Your mind is that strong and that full of it. Jesus says, I want you to love them. I want you to love them. And that's not just in words, but in action and in truth. To truly love them. Well, it's a challenge. The harder Jesus didn't say, love your neighbor, except for that. He doesn't give that escape clause. He will never say to you, it's okay, you cannot like them because I don't like them either. Jesus will never say that to you. He loves them, in fact, He died for them. So we are to love them as well. He says, I want you to specifically, intentionally love them. That's a challenge. That is a challenge. But if we don't love them, how else will they learn of the love of God? How else will they be shown what God's love looks like? How else will the barrier between the two of you cease to exist? How will healing take place in that relationship unless we are willing to love them and step out of our comfort zone and express in action, in truth, but he cares for them. Standing their selves to the side and loving them through Christ Jesus. Allowing Christ to love them through us. You say, well, you know, I love you. Allow God to give you the strength to reach out to yourself and to love them in spite of things. For some of us, we have difficulty loving others because we have difficulty loving ourselves. Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. But if you are loathing of yourself, if you don't love yourself, how can you love God? For some of us, our biggest enemy is looking at us in the mirror. Because that is just one of ourselves as well. Not in some kind of narcissistic self-centered, oh, look at me, I'm God's gift to the point. That's not what he's saying. Rather, accepting the love of God in your life, and this is how God views me, and I'm a child of God, and thank you, Lord, that you have loved me. I have worth to him. I have worth. You have worth to him. See yourself as God sees you. Even when you're broken. He loves you. Even when he acts ugly, he loves you. That's why his word of love for others is God loves them. He loves them enough to lay down his life for them. Greater love was never expressed as when Jesus laid down his life for them. That we might be saved. So God says, love your enemies. He commands us to love one another. In John 13, Jesus says, as I have loved you, so you must love one another. However, we must admit that loving another is not instinctive. It doesn't come naturally to us. Normally, we only love those who love us. And if somebody rejects us, well, then a natural instinct is to reject them. But even though Jesus was rejected by men, he still loved. He still laid down his life for them. The Good Samaritan, even though he was rejected by the woman who was laying left for dead, he still leads beyond himself and helps his enemy. Not instinctive, but he is willing to reach across and to love them in spite of himself. Sometimes we only love those who are abused to us. That's why we need grace. Love one another. Maybe we love because they're like us with similar interests and in some ways look like us or act like us. But this is not what Jesus is speaking of. But Jesus loves regardless of those things. He calls us to love others regardless of those things. I encourage you to reach out to those you don't know. It's comfortable just to stay in your little group or your little circle and just let's have a relationship or let's fellowship with them. But you know what? God desires for us to love the body of Christ. Each other, even if they're not like us, even if they're not our age or they don't have similar interests, we are to love each other. He says, well, I don't believe. Do you know what the cure is for him to know that? Yeah.
Well, they should come talk to me.
They should come talk to me.
You can't rely on them.
Go talk to them. In fact, what blesses my heart is when I hear of you all taking each other, going to lunch with each other, getting to know each other, and not just those who are in your S4 or more. You okay? You okay? Yes. It's easier to stay just in that comfort zone, but if we are to be all that God wants us to be in 2023, we must love each other, not just only in words, but in action and in deed as well. In truth, really care for them. Really care for them. Some of those, there is that love, but then there's that time for judgment. Harshly. Love and not love you for the money you make like that. I'm going to confess to you the days of pain in my life. Is that me? And if I caught somebody in fault, they wouldn't hear that. The harshness, the judgment. But I was right that they had messed up. They have got my check, but I enjoy it. Anybody else? One that can be me. A blessing story to me. How dare you? How dare you? What? How dare I want? He said, I love them. I died for them. How dare you harm the ones I died for? I encourage you to take that to heart, because I know there are those of you here who always take a pleasure in something that is true. Keep in mind that you died for them, and allow that to temper your response. We are to love them as He loves them. We are to love them as He loved them. And He laid down His life for them. So our response should be one of grace and mercy. Is there that time to correct? Absolutely. But heaven forbid it becomes an attitude of judgment. Rather, it should come as the Holy Spirit does, with love and grace. To obey the command of Jesus Christ, He said to us, this is my command, love each other. It's harder than it seems. But if we're to be all we will be, it
God wants us to do, we have to learn this discipline. He never said it could be easy, but he loved it humbly. He said it good. Lord Jesus, I just call you to do it. That you would plant your word deep in our hearts. I pray that you would teach us to love each other as you have loved us. Lord, I pray that you would bring healing to relationships. I pray that we would learn to set swords down and pick up peace and love. Lord, I just thank you for your work in our lives. I thank you that you have loved us. Teach us to love your way. Thank you.